About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host. Boy, it sure is hard to believe that another year has come and gone. I hope you all had a very Merry Christmas and a lovely New Year. But now that it is the New Year, our guest this evening has a breed that I'm sure in this cold weather everyone would love to have. She is Karen Speth, and her breed is Alaskan Malamutes. Real hairy little son of a gun. Karen, suppose you tell us what an Alaskan Malamute is.
An Alaskan Malamute is one of the northern breeds. Mm-hmm. They include Siberian Huskies, Caissons, Samoyeds. These are the freighting dogs. These are the dogs that carry the heavy loads.
Okay.
The Siberians are the speed dogs. Mm-hmm. They do the racing.
Right.
These are more your heavy loads. These were involved with the serum run.
Okay.
With diphtheria in Alaska.
Yes, way back.
Way back,
right. Of course, I don't know that transportation has improved any up there in Alaska, but...
Yeah, they're the steady ones. They didn't do the speed, but they got things there when it needed to get there, and that's about what you need.
So this is basically where they originated, in Alaska?
In Alaska.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
And they were, what, the Malamute Indians?
Malamute Indians, the Inuit tribe.
Okay, the Inuit tribe.
They're the ones who bred them. They're not sure. They were probably mixed with other heavier breed dogs.
Sure.
Descendants of the wolf way
supposedly,
back.
Supposedly, yeah, right. Yeah, we've all heard that,
well,
right?
You know, they were used to haul the sleds in the winter, and then in the summer they were allowed to run and do hunting and things on their own. So basically these guys have a very, very high prey drive. And,
small animals. Yes, I would guess so. And when she's saying small animals, she doesn't only mean necessarily rabbits and mice and things like that, like cats.
Cats can be on the menu, too.
Yeah, cats can be on the menu, too.
They've been known to take down sheep and
oh, my word,
when given the opportunity, some of them.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I know the Huskies are that way, but I was also supposed to have a Siberian Husky on the program this evening as well to show you the difference between the Husky and the Malamute, but our guest hasn't arrived, so I don't know what happened. I hope she's not riding around the city. She was coming from up above Allentown, so I hope she's not just riding around looking for the railroad tracks at 7th and Penn. I don't. You know, we all have GPSs now, so you would think she'd find it, but oh well, who knows. She may arrive later on. I don't know, but we'll talk to Karen while we have Karen, we'll talk to Karen. So then they actually were bred as a heavier dog. They bred like the Mals for this job and the Huskies when they needed to get someplace in a hurry. Mm-hmm.
The Huskies were actually a completely different area and tribe.
Oh, really?
Malamutes are specific to the Inuits.
Okay.
And the Malamute Indians.
Oh,
so
okay.
It depended on what they used them for. These dogs, they were more... And they were good conversationalists.
Yes, very good conversationalists.
When there's no Johnny Carson, so you know, you need to be able to entertain.
And right? Here is Johnny. Of course, she's a girl.
But this is characteristic of Malamutes too. They're very, very vocal.
Yes.
And you may have
but
one.
They really don't bark though.
No. It's a little bit of the wooing that you hear. We call it wooing.
Uh huh. And the yodeling.
And the yodeling.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And every once in a while she'll bark and scare herself. But other than that, where did that come from, right?
Are they also, were the Samoyeds in the same, or were they another separate group yet?
I think they're actually separate.
All three.
Yeah. When the modern sled dogs now are nothing like these. You don't see when you watch the Iditarod.
Yeah.
You very seldom see a full bred Malamute or Siberian team.
Right.
I mean, there are some.
Right.
But for the most part, they have the sled dogs have evolved into their own separate breed.
Right.
For racing.
Right. And they're called Alaskan Huskies. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been bred with other. Like Dobermans.
And
Speedy.
I have poodles, I think, even.
Yeah.
But
well, we know poodles are a little bit goofy. Sorry, poodle breeders out there, but they are a little bit goofy. But they are fast.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they are speedy. Mm-hmm. And you know,
Right.
They do have the coat, mm-hmm. so. The temperament on these, the Mals.
They're tough as far as training. They have a mind of their own.
Okay.
They actually are bred to disobey. They're what we call independent thinkers.
Okay.
So if there's something that you ask them to do and they don't want to do it, you're going to get the no first.
Uh-huh.
Then you have to convince them that they want to do it. But when you think about it, a sled dog team, when you have the lead dog way up in front and the mushers in the back, if you're on thin ice or something like that,
they would have
to not go forward.
That's exactly right.
Everybody would die.
That's exactly it. So. Sure, sure. Yeah, that, and that's, I guess, why for generations they were bred that way, mm-hmm. because they did need, you know, they have better hearing, they have better sense of smell.
Exactly.
You know, they know what's safe and what's not.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess the Mals were bred for exactly the same. They, too, would have been pulling in teams. They didn't put them in teams like a beta 10, though, did they?
It depends. It depends on what they were hauling, really. But about six. It's two wheel dogs and two, four. At least six to eight.
Okay. Okay.
And then your lead dog.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
I just didn't realize that they had put that many together.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was like a four. You know, mm-hmm. so many other pictures. Well, now you got all tangled up.
Sky, come over here. Sky, hey.
This is when
roll back this way.
Right. She's rolling around the floor, really enjoying herself, but she's getting the leash tangled all around her front legs. She really is only a puppy. She's what?
Yeah, she just turned 2 years old.
Two. So basically, for a Mal or a Husky, that is very much a puppy. I don't think they get their brains till they're at least three.
I'm going to say even more. Four.
You know, four, okay.
Till they're in full bloom.
But they're fun dogs. That's, you know, they mm-hmm. are enjoyable because they are so, so silly. They do just such silly things,
mm-hmm.
like now, you know?
We're just finding
sure
a little refining at the table
doing,
here.
But, you know, maybe she doesn't even know what she's doing.
I don't think she has a
but
really
good as
idea.
Far as being good family dogs, they really do enjoy people. It's not
they
that
enjoy
it's...
people.
It's not
mm-hmm.
a good guard dog.
No, they're no. She would be at the door with the silverware.
Okay.
Yes, inviting them in.
Right.
No, they're not good guard dogs. They don't bark. They are very friendly.
Mm-hmm.
As they mature, though, they're friendly on and playful on invitation. So they can sit and ignore you if they want.
Okay.
This one right now doesn't want to ignore.
No, she insists that I have something wonderful. I'm not quite sure what it is. Maybe it's my perfume. I don't know, but
no, it's back there somewhere.
I don't know. Maybe she sees the flowers. Grooming. That's a biggie, right?
Oh yeah.
You can see the coat on this dog. I mean, she's got a mass of coat. This is only, you said she has shed out already.
Yes, she was groomed. We actually used a Furminator on her.
Okay.
So, yeah, there's no, if you can see, there's no real
not
undercoat.
Not very much undercoat,
this
right.
This is all her guard here.
Right.
So she's kind of naked right now. But
you still see the amount of coat that you're going to have to groom through. And you can't just ignore it because if you don't comb it, it's going to get all matted.
Mm-hmm.
And especially around the soft parts, like the ears, underneath the belly. So it's a dog that you have to groom. It's not going to take care of itself. But it is good at night, you know. And it's a cold night. Are these some of the dogs that they called? Well, I guess you determined how cold it was in Alaska by the number of dogs that went to bed with you?
Evidently. I don't know how many they would take with them. But
well, that's where...
I mean, one her size would probably be a good...
Yeah, that's why they said, you know, it's a one-dog night, so it wasn't really cold, and a two and then a three-dog night was really, really frigid. Meanwhile, if you have three of these in bed with you, you know...
You're downright warm.
You're downright warm. You got it. I guess they also use the undercoat on these dogs to knit into the garments that they wore.
I don't know that they did. That's something that started... Just recently in the few years back.
Oh, really?
I know I've had Malamutes now since 72, and I know in maybe about after the second one, maybe about 8 years, about 80, somewhere around there, with the weaving of the alpaca and the
right,
wool and
right.
things, lamb's wool, someone decided, I think it was collie hair, collie fur, they tried. And any of the soft, spinnable,
fluffy stuff,
they'll try. But I don't know that the Indians did.
Oh, really?
The Malamute Indians actually did the Eskimos. I think they used the hides that they had from the seals and things like that.
I just thought from with the babies knitting the fur stuff, but I don't, what else would they have gotten wool from?
I don't know that they did. I think it was all skins.
Was it all skins?
I think so.
Okay. I really should. I don't know what she's looking for.
She's fine.
She's going. Like I said, she's entertaining. But I did have a spinner on the program a couple of months ago that does,
does
flex the hair and spins it into yarn for you to, I mean, she'll knit something for you, but she likes to give you the yarn that you can do your own thing. With health on the guys, since they are big, do you have, is hip dysplasia?
Hip dysplasia is one. Dwarfism was a big one.
Oh,
they've
really?
Kind of eradicated that pretty much with the testing like they do with the eyes.
Okay.
Things like that. Hey.
Now, with dwarfism, with this breed, What would you end up with? Short-legged dogs?
Short-legged, deformed front legs would be deformed. The front leg would splay out, almost like a human dwarf.
Oh my word!
That was very prevalent in the breed years ago. But they've bred that. They're pretty well with that now.
Wow.
The eyes, things like that. Some night blindness, sometimes like that.
Okay. Now they don't get the cataracts. They get the PRA, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I think the Huskies are the ones that get the cataracts, the early...
Yeah, they can get the early cataracts.
Yeah, the juvenile cataracts. But that's not a problem in this...
Not that I know of.
Okay. Do they have blue eyes, too, or is it just...
They're strictly brown eyes.
Strictly brown eyes. Okay.
That's one of the ways you can tell the difference. That and the amount of bone. Her legs are a lot thicker.
Yeah.
Her body is a lot thicker. Her nose is a little shorter.
Yeah. Well, she's also taller.
Mm-hmm.
Huskies are, sort of like... A medium-sized dog, whereas you cannot consider her, even though she's a female and she's smaller than the males, you cannot consider her a small dog in any way, shape, or form.
No.
She's not a medium-sized dog. She's big, and she's long.
Right.
She's really long, but the Huskies were bred with a lighter bone for speed, like you said.
Right.
Now, we did get into, they don't have anything really weird other than the dwarfism.
No.
Okay.
The large dog, basically the problems large dogs would have, you have to watch for bloat, you have to watch for growth things as far as
OCD.
Early OCD.
The growth plates.
Growth plates. The and the hip dysplasia is pretty much what we're looking at.
Yeah. Now, you did say that training on these guys are, it's a... sort of hit or miss kind of thing. You coerce them into doing what you want.
It's like anything else. Dogs are going to do what works for them.
Mm-hmm.
So with these guys, it's a matter of getting comfortable with understanding what's making them tick.
Yeah.
And you're not going to force them to do anything.
No.
Relationship is a big plus with these guys, and you really have to get them to believe that you're the top person.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And it really does benefit them to do the things that you ask them to do?
Yes. If they don't see you as a clear-cut leader, they're going to be the leader at some point.
Mm-hmm.
And then it can get ugly.
Well, I think that's with all breeds of dogs, including your little toy things.
Mm-hmm.
The little toy breeds are, just as a dog this size, you would worry about a growl. But when you're talking about a Chihuahua, you don't worry about the growl, even though it's going to mean a bite, and yeah, it's going to hurt. No, they're not going to take your arm off, like this breed could.
Mm-hmm.
But a bite hurts, whether it's from a little dog or a big dog. Oh, that was clever.
You're very cute.
Yeah,
if we had a hoop, maybe we could have you jump through it, right?
They're not real good at hoop jumping, are they? They're not real good jumpers, are they?
No, they can.
Yeah.
They can jump fences. Six-foot fences.
Oh, really?
You need high fences with those guys.
They can,
and they can climb.
Okay.
They'll figure out a way.
Okay. So they do like a lot of exercise, though?
Moderate amounts. They can be great couch potatoes. They can be great apartment dogs.
Really?
Motivation, you have to motivate these guys. They're not going to go out and run laps around the yard on their own.
You're kidding! Oh my word! No, I would have thought as a northern breed. Of course, I'm sure she just loves this kind of weather.
She probably doesn't
want to come in at all.
Mm-hmm.
But I would have thought that they would have had a lot of. Maybe I'm just.
They have a lot of energy, and the more exercise, as with any dog, the better.
Mm-hmm.
But if they're given their druthers, they're going to lie on the couch with the popcorn and the beer and watch TV.
I just wouldn't have expected it, but maybe I'm thinking of the exercise requirements of a Husky or a Sammy, which, and the Sammy, too, I guess was used, they're basically, I guess, herding dogs.
Yeah.
The Sammys, they were reindeer
herders. They were doing some, they pull some sleds.
They were more of northern farm dog.
Mm-hmm.
Now, all of the northern breeds have the curly tail.
Right.
Of course, we can't see her tail because she's now relaxing. And they all have the pointy ears.
Mm-hmm.
And that's interesting, too. You know, is the pointy... Well, now we can see her tail. There's her tail.
You can sit now.
But with the pointy ears, is... They're very furry ears, so they wouldn't get frostbitten. But maybe that, because it's closer to the body?
If you look at her ears are very... small as compared to her head,
the size
and her
of the
skull,
head,
and that
right.
was, that's part of it.
Yeah.
The closer they are to the body, that's for the warmth. The same thing with the bushy tail. When they lie down at night to sleep in the snow, the tail would go over the head or over the face to protect the nose
and keep
them warm. So they curl up in a nice little ball and
they were really designed for cold
weather. For the north.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's basically how they evolved. Things that if you had your druthers, what would you change about this breed, other than the shedding? What would you change about this breed?
You know, I've thought about that, and there is really nothing I would change about this breed. My first Malamute, I had my first Malamute in 72.
Mm-hmm.
She came from a friend of mine. They had her for a while, and I got her about 5 months old.
Uh-huh.
And I've just been in love with the breed since. They're their own dog.
Yes.
You know, and... They're more like a person than...
It's not a dog that's going to fawn all over you.
No. They will. I mean, she has her moments.
Mm-hmm.
She when she wants something, she'll let me know.
Well, yes, I realized that when she whacked me with her paw out there that I wasn't paying attention. She woo-woo-wooed,
right.
And I didn't pay attention, so she whacked me, and then woo-woo-wooed.
Right.
And I paid attention and scratched her under the chin. But
she's not going to be under... They're not going to be under your feet. You know, if you have something that they want, they'll follow you around.
Okay.
But when it goes away, they'll go away.
Oh, okay. So this isn't going to be a very good obedience dog, a high-achieving obedience dog, or an excellent agility dog?
They can be. But again, you know, it's what's in it for them, and they're notorious for that.
Yeah. It's a lot of food-based training.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of reward-based training.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And of course, we know that food is a primary motivator, so obviously. And why did you select this breed? Just because it was given to you, or did you always sort of like the northern breeds? Did you read Nanook of the North, or
no?
Why?
No, actually, I liked Newfoundlands.
Oh, okay.
When I was younger.
Okay.
But no, it was partly because of the first one that I had.
Okay.
You know, it was just an accident that I got her, and I didn't even know what they were talking about when she told me what it was. She just told me it was this big dog, and she came, she had a small car at the time, and the dog was sitting in the front seat, and I thought it was a person.
Oh, my.
And when she drove up and the dog came out of the car, it's like, oh, my God. Didn't realize this is what you were talking about.
Uh-huh.
But they grow on you. They grow on you. They're one of a kind as far as dogs go. But then anybody who has a breed that they love will tell you the same thing.
That's exactly right. You know, there was a breed made for everyone, and if you don't get the breed... Well, like your friend. This was not the breed for her,
right.
So, you know, it was best to find a home for the dog rather than keep it and hate it or tie it outside. You know, I don't understand people who tie dogs. I just don't understand that. If you want a companion, which is why you bought a dog, it stays in the house with you. Why in heaven's name would you buy a dog and then put it outside in a pen or on a chain. It's like, it's ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. But what? That's me. Approximate cost in these guys. First of all, is there any breeder of the males in this area?
She actually came from a breeder in Harrisburg.
Oh, okay. Okay.
There are some breeders locally. I'm not too familiar with them. I've been exclusively basically with her.
Okay. But Harrisburg isn't that far away if you want a mow, you know.
And cost is it's typical with any dog, you know, you're going to pay
I would think for, amount. A show dog would probably be about
$1,500. Yeah. And usually a little under $1,000 for the pet quality.
Okay.
Depending.
But you're still getting the excellent health. Because, a person who's breeding these for the show ring, they're going to want the good temperament. They're going to want a healthy dog because they're keeping one. You know, you're taking this dog into the ring and saying, this is what I bred. Isn't it absolutely gorgeous? So even though you may only want a pet, your breeder has bred the best possible dog that they could, and they're pets for, strange reasons. She doesn't have the perfect coat. She has a longer coat than she should have. You know, the hair is too long. It should be a little bit shorter. Mm-hmm. Now, how does that affect her as a pet? In no way, shape, or form does it affect her as a pet. Some of the dog's ears aren't as up high on the head as they should be. That makes a pet. It's not the best in the litter, so it's a pet. So you sell it as a nice pet. Most pets are sold to the general public with restrictions as far as neutering, because they're selling these dogs to you because they are not the best, so they should not be bred. A lot of people don't understand that. You know, they go over to the mall and they say, oh, well, go ahead and breed this dog and we'll buy all the puppies back. If it's not the best, why do you want to breed it? Especially with nowadays, dogs aren't selling. Just look in the newspaper. If you don't have a job or you're in, sort of limbo that you don't know whether you're going to have a job or not, you certainly aren't going to buy a dog. I mean, that would be just ridiculous because dogs are more expensive. You know, you got the feeding, you got the vet, the grooming bills. If you're not grooming yourself, then you have all these other extra added expenses that you don't really need. So now that we talked about that, you also do a pet, a puppy class.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get into that for just a few minutes. You have a puppy class starting middle of January, but mm-hmm. I think at this point it's probably already full. Over full, okay. I know you and I both do a puppy class, and I know how I feel mm-hmm. about a dog going to a puppy class, just John Q. Public bringing their dog to a puppy class. How do you feel it benefits people to come to a puppy class?
The socialization is very important with these dogs, especially,
all dogs.
But all dogs.
Yes.
I actually took courses at Kutztown uh-huh. University on behavior and on training, and one of the things that they're finding is that the breeder should be taking a little more responsibility as far as socializing their litters
right.
when they get them. I mean, there are some breeders who do, there are some breeders that don't.
Mm-hmm.
And with the puppies, they're ready, they're sent home with their owners, their new owners, at between 8 and 10 weeks old.
Correct.
And by that time, they should have had some form of human socialization before that. Between 5 and 8 weeks.
Yes.
And the only person that can do that is the breeder.
Yes.
Because you can't, by law, mm-hmm. I guess it's Pennsylvania state law, you can't allow a dog to be sold before it's, I think it's like
seven weeks.
Mm-hmm. So you have 2 weeks right there that you've lost.
Right.
So it's very important to get them into classes. One of the things is with inoculations, a lot of the classes would only take puppies after their last set of shots.
Correct.
We're done, because I operate through the veterinarian that I work for. Most of the puppies that come to me are through our clinic, so we have the luxury of being able to get them together at a younger age
right.
because they've had their
yes.
first inoculation.
Yes. But I know I have that with a lot of people who contact me about puppy classes. Their vet tells them, don't take the puppy to class until it's had its last set
right.
of shots, and
mm-hmm.
it's like, if the dog gets some kind of like it does get distemper, although why after two inoculations it should get distemper, it should already be fairly well inoculated right. mm-hmm. with two injections. But with distemper, if the puppy does get distemper, it's treatable. If your dog is not socialized and becomes somewhat aggressive with other dogs or other people because it hasn't been socialized, or it becomes extremely shy, how do you treat that? It's not something that you can call back and say, well, we'll give it a shot for this.
Right.
So this is where I disagree with right. a lot of the veterinarians and some of the veterinarians in this area as well. They're still saying, oh no, wait until the dog is 16 weeks old. You lost too much time.
I think there's a window of opportunity, well, I know. There's a window of opportunity up to about 15 weeks.
Yes.
For any socialization.
That's exactly right.
And the window closes quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you've surpassed that time, you don't know what you have.
Right.
You don't know what you have, and you can't get it back.
Right.
No, you can't.
That's exactly right.
So, you know, I think, is it Dodson, mm-hmm. Nicholas Dodson, who Dodson. Has the 100 a day rule. 100 new
experiences
yes. a day.
Yes.
So it's like, you know, when you think about it, it's overwhelming to
right.
some people what you need to do. But, it, you know, just getting them out to the Petco, PetSmart, mm-hmm. places like that
right.
Is great.
Right. And
you just
right.
need to.
You know, and if the dog hasn't had all of its inoculations up to that point, you know, when the dog is like, 13 weeks old, and you're going to take it to some place like PetSmart or Petco, have it ride in the cart. It's only a little dog. I mean, even a dog like this at 12 weeks is only this big. So, you know, you throw it in the cart and wheel it around. Don't let it walk around, you know, especially don't let it meet other dogs nose to nose if it hasn't been totally inoculated. But, you know, if you're going into a structured environment like, you know, a puppy class where you know all the puppies have been inoculated, mm-hmm. you know, this is... you know, it's great. It's great. I know a lot of vets do at this point see the benefits.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. they're seeing the benefits because they're able to manage the puppies the owner is able to manage the puppies when they come into the clinic. They know what to do. So the owner is getting the training as well. So anyhow, that's our program for this evening. Obviously, our Siberian Husky person didn't come, but we didn't really need them either, did we? I do want to tell you about next month's program. We are going to have an animal communicator. She talks to the animals. Her name is Anita Curtis. Maybe some of you are familiar with her. It should be a very, very interesting program. She communicates by telephone through the owner, but she does talk to the dog. So you might want to mark it on your calendar next month to stay tuned. We will be talking to an animal communicator who will be talking to, I guess, some dogs. Who knows? I don't know. But for this evening, good night.